I would like to introduce the next speaker, Jenny van Dongen. She's an assistant professor at VU Amsterdam. And yeah.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm here today to present some of our recent work on epigenomics and twins. This is my title, which is basically the title of a paper that we recently published, where we identified an epigenetic signature of identical twinning. Twins, of course, they have been studied for centuries. Perhaps surprising, there's very little that we know about the cause of identical twinning. Of course, monozygotic twin pairs or identical twin pairs, they're fascinating subjects. They derive from a single fertilized egg cell that splits at some point into two halves or even more. In this figure is a widely hypothesized display of how it's thought to occur, so that there are actually three types of these monozygotic twin pairs that differ in the amount of sharing of their placenta and chorion. And this has been hypothesized to be linked to the time when they split. So there's a hypothesis that when the embryo splits at the two-cell stage, that this gives rise to two twins, identical twins, who have a separate placenta, separate chorion, etc. But this is all a hypothesis, and actually there is very little that we know about the mechanisms that gives rise to identical twins. There had been some indications that perhaps something might be going on in the epigenome. I study epigenetics, and so I've looked and worked a lot with DNA methylation data. But basically, what we know is that the time when identical twins are thought to arise is a very important period when global epigenetic reprogramming occurs. There's also a known link between assisted reproductive technologies, and in particular IVF, where after these technologies, the incidence of monozygotic twins is increased. And there are also suggestions that one possible mechanism by which this association might arise is because there might be an effect on epigenetic programming. And then there's also a very interesting connection to imprinting disorders. In particular, Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome is one of these imprinting disorders of which it is quite well known that the incidence of monozygotic twin pairs is tenfold higher among patients compared to the general population. And interestingly, most of these pairs are discordant for this disorder. I should also point out that there's very little evidence for any genetic influences on identical twinning. The prevalence is very stable across the world, and it also typically does not run in families. So we decided to look at DNA methylation. We had a very simple aim, simply to test if there are any methylation differences between monozygotic twins and other individuals. In our main analysis, we took dizygotic twins as a control group because they are the ideal control group in the sense that they also share similar prenatal conditions. They also share a womb together. But we also, of course, in secondary analysis, looked whether there's a difference between both types of twins and non-twin individuals. We analyzed methylation array data from Illumina 450K and EPIC arrays. So these are array-based technologies that are very useful because they are relatively straightforward to apply to large numbers of individuals, large numbers of samples. And we analyzed methylation data from two main sources, blood cells and buccal cells. So these buccal swabs, they mainly consist of epithelial cells. And these two cell types are derived from different embryonic cell layers. So during the gastrulation stage, around day 7 is when these different cell layers are formed. The ectodermal cell layer in the end gives rise to the epithelial cells that we can collect in buccal swabs. And the mesodermal cell layer gives rise to blood cells. And one of the hypotheses is that if you would find a methylation difference that is present in multiple cell types, then this could be an indication that it is established very early in development, so before the formation of different cell layers. We initially started this study in the Netherlands Twin Register, which is where I am based, and we had a discovery sample of almost 2,000 twins. We compared these monozygotic twins to the dizygotic twins to identify spots in the genome where we see a difference in methylation level, and we started with data from blood from adult twins, mean age of 35 years. And I must say, to my surprise, we found quite a large number of hits, over 200 different differentially methylated sites. They occur in clusters in the genome, so they tend to cluster in regions where methylation level is different across a larger region. We see both locations where there's higher methylation level in monozygotic twins and other locations where there's a lower methylation level. Very interesting, of course. And one of the first things that we wanted to know is, what is this and does it replicate? So we turned towards several other twin registers from the UK, from Finland, from Australia, asking if they wanted to run a replication analysis. We also had one additional data set from buccal cells from children, but all of these other cohorts had methylation data like us from whole blood samples, and we then also combined all of these data in a meta-analysis of methylation in blood. We also looked whether we could, with panelized regression models, derive a score, a methylation score, a classifier basically, to see how well we can predict whether someone is a monozygotic twin based on their methylation profile. And we performed functional follow-up analyses to get an indication of what these loci are involved in. So what are we looking at? And we also analyzed data on chorionicity, so these different types of monozygotic twin pairs, but which I will not cover today, actually, in my presentation. This is an overview of the data that were available in the different twin cohorts. And most of them had methylation data from blood cells. And in our meta-analysis, we included the data from the twins, where we compared monozygotic twins to dizygotic twins. And then we also performed a number of sensitivity analyses in which we also compared both types of twins to non-twin family members. And the panelized regression model, so where we built the model to actually predict whether a person is a monozygotic twin, those models also used the non-twin relatives. But first of all, so as I said, in the Netherlands Twin Register, we identified more than 200 differentially methylated locations, and we first of all looked whether these locations replicate in different data sets, and we actually found a remarkable degree of replication. So in these figures, you can see the effect size on the horizontal axis in the Netherlands Twin Register, and then the effect size on the y-axis in these other twin cohorts, with, in the final figure, the effect size in buccal cells. So even if we take methylation measured in a completely different cell type, we still see replication of these effects, which was really interesting to see. And I should also point out that all of these cohorts contain adult twin pairs. So this is something that is still present many decades after this twinning event occurred. The buccal cells came from children. So we then performed, as I said, a number of sensitivity analyses to, first of all, compare monozygotic twins to non-twins, so parents and siblings, which is where we also replicated this effect. On the other hand, when we compared dizygotic twins to non-twin individuals, we did not see this effect. So it really appears to be something that is specific to monozygotic twins. We also performed some analyses like separately in men and women, including only one twin of each pair or both twins, that all didn't really make a difference for the conclusions. We also corrected for the top methylation QTL of each CpG site in cis to get an indication of whether these findings might be driven by genetic effects, so differences in genotype in identical twins, but this was not the case. So when we corrected for methylation QTLs, that didn't change the results at all. And in our meta-analysis, so combining all the blood methylation data from almost 6,000 individuals, we found more than 800 different differentially methylated sites. Interestingly, this signal was strongly enriched near telomeres and centromeres, one of the findings that we still do not fully understand, actually, what's going on in those telomeres and centromeres. So if anyone has any ideas about that, I'm very interested to hear about that. So based on our enrichment analyses. So we performed actually two types of enrichment analyses, one based on the nearest genes of these differentially methylated locations, and one based on transcription factor binding sites. So we annotated each of the CpGs to transcription factor motifs and then annotated the transcription factors to the genes that they target and in which pathways those genes are involved. Based on the transcription factor analyses, we found that there was significant enrichment of several very early embryonic processes driven by homeobox transcription factors. So very interestingly, this is really pointing to something that's going on very early in embryonic development. And based on the nearest genes, one of the interesting findings, which is shown in these figures over here, was that one of the strongest enriched pathways was based on cell adhesion, which of course, had been an interesting, or actually a candidate mechanism that has been hypothesized for a long time to potentially be involved in this splitting of the embryo. And then we also saw enrichment in several developmental signaling pathways. We also looked at whether anything is going on in these imprinted genes, because as I mentioned, there's a connection with several imprinting disorders, but none of the locations where we saw differential methylation in identical twins is in imprinted genes. Interestingly, we did see a very strong enrichment in so-called metastable epialleles. So these loci where there's systemic variation in DNA methylation that is basically correlated across tissues. So you see it in different types of tissues. And it is the methylation state at these loci is thought to be established around implantation of the embryo. So that's an interesting observation. A couple of conclusions before I would like to show you a couple of more implications of our findings. But basically, we think that we have identified a molecular signature of the monozygotic twinning event that persists through many rounds of mitosis to adult somatic tissues. We do not know whether these methylation differences are a cause or an effect, basically, of this splitting of the embryo, but it's the first clue that we have about an event that has basically been a mystery for years. We now know that something is going on in the epigenome, and it shows remarkable replication across cohorts. We very much hope that these findings will also be taken forward by embryologists and molecular biologists who can design experiments to basically find out whether any of this is something that causes the embryo to split. These findings also provide completely new possibilities to examine certain congenital disorders that are more common in monozygotic twins, and also that have been linked to the so-called vanishing twin syndrome. So there are several congenital disorders that are more common in monozygotic twins, and it has been hypothesized that many of the patients with these disorders that are not born with a twin might have actually had a monozygotic twin who died very early in development. So because we saw this strong replication of this methylation signature, we decided to test how well can we actually predict based on a DNA sample of a person whether that person is a monozygotic twin. So we trained a predictor based on methylation data, and we achieved an area under the curve of around 0.80. The performance was quite similar in blood cells and Buckel cells. So even though this was trained on blood cells, also in Buckel cells, it worked similar. So certainly not perfect, but we found it quite encouraging if we compare it to many other biomarkers. And this finding in particular, that we could perhaps use this to apply it to individuals and predict whether they had a monozygotic twin that they were not aware of, received lots of media attention. I also received lots of emails from people who are interested to find out if they had a vanishing twin, or who would like to participate in our research. And many people are eager to donate their DNA or even frozen embryos. As I mentioned, and this is my last slide, I will wrap up here. So there are several rare congenital disorders that are more common in monozygotic twins. One group of disorders is neural tube defects. And we could use our findings to predict whether patients that are apparently singletons might also have had a vanishing twin. We looked for one of these neural tube defects, one of these examples, at publicly available methylation data sets. Unfortunately, the sample sizes were very small. So for this particular group of disorders, we did not find any evidence for our hypothesis, but there's much room still for improvement, especially in terms of increasing sample size. And my slide is not moving anymore. Yep, but that was my final slide. So with that, I would like to thank all the people who contributed to this study, and thanks to the organizer of this meeting for the opportunity to speak here.
Anybody have any questions?
Hi, Annie. It's a fascinating story, and I read it, and I'm still impressed. So you haven't shown any data on the X chromosome, like in many GWAS and EWAS. They seem to forget about the X chromosome, but have you looked into it, and is there perhaps also a link to a non-random X inactivation?
Yes, thank you for this very interesting question. We did not include the X chromosome in our meta-analysis. But that's indeed something that we might want to look at further, because that's, of course, indeed, as you mentioned, in terms of X chromosome inactivation, perhaps an interesting follow-up point to look at. But basically, we did not include it because we have array data where we cannot distinguish the two X chromosomes. And we started out the most simple analysis that is possible, so including both men and women. And if we would have to look at the X chromosome, that would require a slightly more advanced analysis, but definitely worth follow-up.
Okay, well, thank you for your very interesting talk.